Lady Elliot Island is full of life in the Great Barrier Reef. To explore the underwater cities of the coral formations, just grab a snorkel, flippers, and mask and dive in.
So corals, basically, you can think of as kind of like high-rise buildings. So the more branches they build, the higher they grow, the more space there is for fish to live. So fish come to the corals in order to get protection from other larger fish that may otherwise eat them.
The coral homes are created through coral spawning, which is a reproduction process that occurs simultaneously between all 600 different coral species.
It's basically like going to the craziest singles bar you can ever imagine, right? Individual coral colonies will put out eggs and sperm that'll float to the surface, and they'll basically impregnate one another. Then that produces something called a coral larvae, so basically a coral baby. That baby will then settle to the bottom, try and find a safe place to live, a good place to establish its home.
Coral can spawn right next to one another. However, they will fight each other for more space in order to grow their individual colonies.
Coral reefs are basically full of these different corals, which can be good neighbors or they can be bad neighbors, right? You can get really intense battles for space between these corals where there'll be all-out wars, and just like any battle, you'll see winners and you'll see losers.
There are many symbiotic relationships in the Great Barrier Reef, where coral and its inhabitants benefit from one another.
Probably the most classic is the symbiosis between the coral and these little tiny microscopic algae that live inside. So the way that symbiosis works is the coral gives the algae a safe place to live, and in return, the algae does photosynthesis and shares some of the energy that it creates with the coral.
So that's the macroalgae.
There are many coral relationships in the Great Barrier Reef, but with climate change threats, these relationships may cease to exist.
So when you have really hot summers that are brought on by things like greenhouse gases, increasing sea surface water temperatures, then they are not adapted to live in those conditions. And what will happen a lot of times is you'll get coral bleaching.
The heat causes the algae to release harmful toxins into the coral. The coral expel their symbiotic relationship with algae and become bleached. Without treatment, the coral will die.
If we can move to more sustainable energy sources like solar, wind, algae for biodiesel, things like that, then we can start to put less CO2 into the atmosphere. We can start to slow the rate of climate change, which will give these reefs a better chance of surviving.
Since the inception of the solar power station on Lady Elliot Island, diesel use and carbon emissions have been reduced by more than 80%.
There's technologies that currently exist to reduce our CO2 emissions, and they may be more costly than the ones we currently use, but I would argue that in the long run, those costs are very small in relation to the potential costs of losing irreplaceable ecosystems such as the coral reefs.
Just as our actions, thousands of miles away, can cause harm to the coral reefs all the way in Australia, what happens to the coral over there can impact everyone else as well. Larissa Liska, UT Australia.